your Bibles, open up to Ephesians chapter 3. We're going to continue through Ephesians. I know today is Father's Day, but much like we did on Mother's Day, sometimes I struggle with, do we keep going on or do we kind of stop? So because on Mother's Day we kept going through Ephesians, only fair that we do the same with fathers. But we can, we will, notice in this passage God is Father, but also look at the responsibility of fathers once we hit the end of this passage, because one thing that I've realized as being a parent is the responsibility that comes on that, not just of providing food and shelter and keeping kids clean, but the influence that we have spiritually, the influence that we have to teach and train our children on what it means to know God and love Him and follow Him. And so we're going to wrap all that up into this passage towards the end. So as we first started talking about the book of Ephesians, as we started looking at kind of the context of when Paul wrote it, what was going on in Paul's life when he wrote it, one of the things that we mentioned was that Paul is finishing up a seven-year stint in jail, in prison, as he writes this letter. Paul was in prison not because he was doing anything bad, not because he was doing anything immoral. Paul was in prison because he was proclaiming the gospel, because he was going around city to city, planting churches and telling people about Jesus Christ, who he is and what he has done. Because of that, as people got saved, that kind of upset some of the natural flow of some people's life, sometimes of the economy, of where he was at. If you remember in Ephesus, it is a city that is kind of greatly influenced and governed by the temple, the cult to Artemis, a false goddess. And so that impacted their economy, that impacted so much of what they did. It caused a bit of a riot almost when Paul was in Ephesus, because people were surrendering their lives to Christ, and it was making the tradesmen mad. And so as all this stuff happens, people are like, well, this guy's at fault. And so he gets arrested, he gets thrown in jail. And so one of the reasons that Paul is writing this letter to these believers in Ephesus is because they look at Paul and they're burdened for him. They're devastated that their mentor, their spiritual hero, is sitting in prison. And so there's two parts that kind of come with that. There's one where they care about him. They don't want him to be sitting in prison, especially since he didn't do anything wrong or anything bad. But also there's that worry, there's that concern that if Paul ended up in prison for telling people about Christ, what's to keep us from being thrown in prison as well? And so as we look at this passage this morning, we'll look at Ephesians 3, 1 through 13, Paul is both encouraging and challenging this church. He is both encouraging and challenging these believers that in the midst of this suffering, in the midst of this imprisonment, that Paul would do it over and over and over again because of why he is there and because of what is happening because of that. So if you're able, I'm going to ask that you stand in the honor of reading God's word. We'll read Ephesians chapter 3, verses 1 through 13. Then we'll pray. You may be seated, and we'll start working through the passage. Paul says this: "For this reason, I, Paul, a prisoner for Christ Jesus, on behalf of you Gentiles, assuming that you have heard of the stewardship of God's grace that has been given to me for you, how the mystery made known to me by revelation, as I have written briefly, when you read this, you can perceive my insight into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to the sons of men in other generations, as it has now been revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. This mystery is that the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, and partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Of this gospel I was made a minister, according to the gift of God's grace, which was given to me by the working of his power. To me, though I am the very least of all the saints, this grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to bring to light for everyone what is the plan of the mystery hidden for ages in God who created all things, so that through the church the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. This was according to the eternal purpose that he has realized in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence through our faith in him. So I ask you not to lose heart over what I'm suffering for you, which is for your glory. Let's pray. Father God, we come before you now and thank you for this time that you have given us, Father God, to come and to worship you. Father God, to recognize and acknowledge that you are a good, good Father, God, who loves us immensely more than we could ever imagine or request or ask or think that we need. Father God, I pray this morning as we look at this passage, as we look at your scripture, Father God, that you would speak through your word and through the Holy Spirit to our hearts, to our minds, God, louder than my voice ever could. God, that you would challenge, that you would encourage, that you would convict. Father God, whatever it is that we need, wherever it is that we are at, God, that you would meet us and that you would draw us closer to yourself. We love you and we thank you. It's in Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. You may be seated. All right, so as we talked about the historical context, Paul was in prison. It's also important to remember the grammatical context. So Paul starts off in verse 1. He says, "For this reason, I, Paul." So Paul is following this up from what he talked about in the previous passage, what we looked at last week. If you remember what we looked at last week, we talked about that Paul has speaking to this primarily Gentile audience, and he is talking about how, look, you were once far off from Christ, you were separated from Christ, you were separated from God, but now you have been brought close to him through the gospel. We talked about unity, how there's no more Jew and Gentile, but there is one body, but one of the themes was there was once separation, now there is closeness. And just as a reminder, because it's going to come up again later in the passage, but last week we talked about how Paul used this illustration of the Old Testament temple or tabernacle. The way the Temple Mount was set up is it kind of worked outwards. You had the Holy of Holies inside the temple. That was the representative place of God's throne. That's where in Solomon's temple the Shekinah glory of God dwelt, that kind of visual presence of God. It's where the priest, the high priest, was only allowed to go in once a year to offer sacrifices for the people. And then as you moved out to these different areas, only certain people were allowed in. So you moved out to the rest of the temple, that's only the priests could go in there. You moved out to this court where only the Levites and priests, and you moved out even farther and the men could come in here. And then you moved out farther and you had the court of the women. And then as you moved out even farther, you had the court of the Gentiles, or kind of the outer ring of the Temple Mount. And so for the Gentiles, when it came to if they were turning over and becoming Jews in their religion, and they were renouncing all their pagan religions, and they were saying, we're going to follow the one true God, the God of Israel, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, you had what was representative of God's presence, and they were way back here. There was this separation. Just remember that, because that's going to come back up in a little bit. But the first thing that I want us to see in verses 1 and 2 is that Paul encourages his listeners to examine their purpose and their mission in life. Look at verses 1 and 2. Paul says, "For this reason, I, Paul, a prisoner of Christ, on behalf of you Gentiles." So Paul is what is called the apostle to the Gentiles. So Jesus Christ came as a Jew. He came to Israel. His disciples were Israelites. As Jesus Christ died and rose again and ascended, and he gives the Great Commission, he tells them to take the gospel to Jerusalem, Judea, to the uttermost parts, Samaria, and then to the uttermost parts of the world. Well, of the disciples, most of them kind of stayed in that central area, at least initially. And Paul got saved after Jesus Christ ascended into heaven, but he was called by Christ to be an apostle, and he was the apostle that took the gospel out to the Gentiles, or the non-Jews. And so Paul says that he is a prisoner of Christ on behalf of the Gentiles. That's what God has called him to do. Verse 2 says, "Assuming that you have heard of the stewardship of God's grace that was given to me." So the stewardship, that word in the Greek carries the idea of administration. If you're looking at a household, the one that was the steward or had that role of stewardship was the household servant that was kind of in charge of the day-to-day business of the house. They're the ones that took care of everything. There was a responsibility given to them that said, this is your responsibility to take care of the business of the house. Well, Paul says that his stewardship, or that his responsibility, is of the God's grace that was given to him for you. As Paul talks about the stewardship that was given to him of God's grace, he's basically saying, this is God's mission for me. This is God's purpose for my life. We like to talk about purpose, right? Paul says, my purpose in life is to tell people about the gospel. This grace that was given to me, we understand that grace is getting something that we do not deserve, and God's grace is shown to us through the gospel. We don't deserve God's love. We don't deserve God's favor. We don't deserve God's mercy or his forgiveness, but God chooses to show us that anyways because of his great love for us. And Paul says, this gift of grace that was given to me, it was given to me so that I could share it with others. And Paul says, this is my mission. This is my purpose. Now, I just want to say this so that we don't just think, oh, that's great for Paul. That is true for us as well. All Christians are called to be ambassadors. All Christians are called to be missionaries. All Christians are called to take the gospel and tell other people about Jesus Christ. We all have this stewardship. We all have this mission or this purpose given to us. But Paul is not just driven by some kind of bland purpose statement or just some kind of, well, I was told to do this, so let me just kind of operate out of just kind of rote obedience. No, Paul also does this, or Paul is willing to suffer for the gospel because of the life change that comes along with it. So in verses 3 through 6, Paul uses the word mystery three different times. The first two times he's talking about the mystery of God that's been revealed to him, this revelation that came from God that did not come to previous generations, and he's talking about Jesus, and he tells us that the third time that he uses it, that the gospel is even for the Gentiles. Remember, in the Old Testament, they had been given promises of God, that salvation was through trusting in the promises of God, but Jesus is the fulfillment of that promise. So Paul is saying this mystery that existed in the Old Testament has been fulfilled in Jesus. Let's read verses 3 through 6. It just says, how the mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I have written briefly. When you read this, so you read my letters, you read what I'm saying, you can perceive my insight into the mystery of Christ, which was not made known to the sons of men in other generations, that's the Old Testament, as it has now been revealed by his holy apostles and the prophets and the Spirit. That's God revealing through the apostles, God revealing through the disciples, through Jesus Christ, writing these letters, the things, the teachings of Christ being now revealed, and the life of Christ being revealed to those now on earth. This mystery is that the Gentiles are fellow heirs, members of the same body, partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. In verse 6, Paul takes the idea of this mystery, the mystery of Christ, that the Old Testament looks forward to, that we understand and comprehend because we have the Gospels, we have the New Testament, which, as Paul is writing this, they didn't have. And so Paul is revealing to them this mystery, and he kind of breaks it down, the mystery that the Gentiles, into four truths: that they are fellow heirs, members of the same body, partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus, and that this is through the gospel. Paul has built his life around this proclamation of the gospel. Yes, there is a calling on his life. But Paul also knows that there is a transformation, that there is a life change, that there is an eternity change that comes with telling people about Christ. And he kind of lays it out in just four simple areas, or really three, and then the way is the fourth. But the first is the Gentiles are fellow heirs. Paul has a desire to see lost people become saved. He has a desire to see those who are separated from God become fellow heirs with God in Christ. What this means is we are joint heirs with Christ, meaning God is the Father and we are the sons and daughters of God. We talk about, well, one of the benefits, one of the great things about Christianity is that when we repent of our sins and place our faith and trust in Jesus, we don't just enter into some kind of religion based on rules. We don't just start worshiping some deity that's kind of some high in the sky that has no concern about us or our daily lives or who we are. We enter into this relationship with a God who adopts us as his children, that he becomes our father, not because he had to, but because he chose to love us. I was born out of wedlock. My mom had me when she found out she was pregnant. When I was born, she tried desperately to get my biological father to have some interest in me, to care about me, to want to be involved in my life, and it was just squat, nothing. He had no desire, neither did his mom, to have anything to do with me. I was rejected as a child. Somewhere in that first year of life, I think, or right after my first birthday, my mom and my dad started to date. And then they got married, I think, when I was 2 years old. And not long after they got married, my dad adopted me. Legally, through all the papers, he adopted me to make me not just the son of this other guy, but to make me his child, to love me the same way he loves my other brother and sisters who are biologically his. That though I'm not biologically his, though we don't share DNA, I am his in every sense of the word, because he has adopted me to be his son. In the same way, when we place our faith and trust in Jesus Christ, God adopts us as his children. And it doesn't matter how bad our fathers might have been or how great our fathers might have been. We now have a father who is perfect. We now have a father who loves us immensely and greater than anyone else ever could. And Paul, as he makes this point about the Gentiles being fellow heirs, he's saying that there comes this life change when we place our faith and trust in Christ. And this is driving Paul, that he wants to see people who have been rejected be adopted into God's family. He said they're fellow heirs, members of the same body. He wants to see the body of Christ grow. He wants to see the church grow. Look, the church is not a building. If this building were to fall apart, if this building were to burn down or blow away, guess what? The church still exists. The church is you and I. We are the church. And Paul's desire is to see the body of Christ mature and grow and get bigger, and the kingdom of God to see it expand. Can I tell you one of the saddest things? Is when a church has no desire to grow. There was a church in the town that I grew up in that I knew friends of the pastors there. And when they were hired, they had church members, not just a couple, the vast majority of the church, tell them, we have no desire to grow. We don't want anyone else coming. We are content and happy with what we are and with who we are. We just want you to kind of watch over us and preach a couple of messages, but don't go do evangelism. Don't go invite people. We are what we are, and we don't want to be anything else. When that's the attitude of a church, you're saying, I don't care about people. I don't love people. I don't want to see people come to know Christ. I don't care that God loved them enough himself that he sent his son. I want what I want. And that is the direct opposite of what Paul is saying here, the seeing them come part of the body, that Paul's desire is to see the kingdom of God expand. And that should drive us to see God's kingdom get greater, to get bigger. Because when God's kingdom gets bigger, that means people are being saved. When people are saved, it means they're not facing the punishment of their sins, but they are adopted into God's family. And then he says, partakers of the promise in Christ Jesus. The promise that comes in Christ Jesus, that's the new covenant, the covenant of his blood, that when we trust Jesus, we are forgiven, we are adopted into God's family, that this is all done through Jesus Christ. This glorifies glorifies Jesus, this honors Jesus, this makes much of Jesus. When we proclaim the gospel and we tell people that salvation is through Jesus and Him alone, and they trust Jesus Christ, that's not just about us telling them, that's not just about them receiving, but that magnifies and glorifies and exalts the greatness and the love and the goodness of God shown through His Son, Jesus Christ. And that this is all happens through the gospel. He says, through the gospel. The gospel, very simply, is that God is holy and we are sinners. And because God is holy and we are sinners, there is separation. And God is also just and He is righteous. And because we have broken His law, we deserve punishment. But God chose to love us enough that He sacrificed His own Son to die for us. That if we would trust Him and repent of our sins, that He will take us, He will wipe us clean, He will draw us back to Himself, and we will be His. The only way someone is saved is through the person and the work of Jesus Christ. Not through church attendance. Not through being a good moral person. Not through some kind of karmic of having your good outweigh your bad mentality. It's not from any other god or any other religion. The only way anyone is saved who will ever be saved is through Jesus Christ. And Paul understands this, and this is why Paul writes in Romans 10, 14 through 15, "How then will they call on Him in whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in Him on whom they have not heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? And how are they to preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news." Paul, sitting in a prison cell, says, "I am content with this. I'm content with sufferings." You know why? Because people are hearing the gospel. Because lives are being changed. Because God is being glorified. Paul is burdened for the glory and the greatness of God, but also for the souls of humanity. Now, let me ask us a question. Are we burdened for people? What is the mission of our life, right? I'm going to ask myself, Kim, what is the mission? What is the purpose of my life? I'm asking you, what is the mission? What is the purpose of your life? You want to know how you figure that out? What do you daydream about? What gets you excited? Where do you spend your time? Where do you spend your money? Where do you spend your resources? I want to give you literally just 10 seconds, but I want you to think about, what is the purpose? What is the direction? What is the goal? What is the mission of my life? Seriously, take 5-10 seconds. Just literally think about that. My throat's dry. I'm going to get a drink while you think. Now, for being honest, how many of us had the proclamation of the gospel as number one? How many of us had it in our top five? Honestly, if we have not shared the gospel nor prayed for the lost in the past few days or the past few weeks, it's not part of our mission. We might be comfortable. We might have nice houses. We might have nice jobs. We might have cushy bank accounts. We might have athletic kids. And all of that is great, but none of that is eternal. You know what's eternal? God, His Word, and the souls of people. We are to be people who are concerned for the greatness of God and through and for people. And you know where those two things come together? The gospel of Jesus Christ. People hearing the gospel and people trusting Him for salvation. So as we move on, I do want to give a little story and brag on one of my children. The other night, we got home from VBS. We're all sitting in Josiah's room. That's our youngest. Kids are getting ready for bed. And so before we put them to bed, I say, let's all pray before we go to bed. Now, before I come across looking super spiritual, I was tired. I wanted them to go to bed. And so I just kind of went through the motions and just kind of prayed as generic a prayer as I guess you can pray. And then Amelia, our second child, she said, "Can I pray?" And I said, "Sure, go ahead." She starts to pray, a very simple prayer. She thanks God for her day. She thanks God for her family. And then she prays, God, I pray that you would save everyone that is lost and everyone who is an enemy of you, that you would make them your child. And here I am, the preacher, kind of going through these motions, and here's her with this heart saying, we need to see people saved. We need to see people's life changed. It was a burden on her six-year-old heart. There's a quote from Charles Spurgeon that kind of fits this, I think, about this desire that we should have, and it says this. It says, if sinners be damned, at least let them leap to hell over our dead bodies. And if they perish, let them perish with our arms wrapped about their knees, imploring them to stay. If hell must be filled, let it be filled in the teeth of our exertions, and let no one go unwarned and unprayed for. We should be burdened for the lost. And if we're not, then we should be convicted. All right, so that's the first half of the passage. We're going to speed through the second half where Paul kind of challenges this church. So in verse 7, he makes sure that they know that this is all about God. He says, of this gospel I was made a minister according to the gift of grace, which was given me by the working of his power. Paul, before he came to know Christ, was super religious, but he did not know God. His life changed, and everything moving forward is not something that he just one day woke up and said, hey, this is what I'm going to do. But this is something that God did in him, and God is doing through him. The power, the ability, is not done by him. It is given to him by God. Guess what? The same Holy Spirit that lived inside of Paul lives inside of you if you have placed your faith and trust in Jesus as your Lord and Savior. The same strength, the same power, the same ability we have because we serve the same God, united in the same Christ. God is calling each and every one of us to go and to take the gospel out and to tell people about Christ. And we don't do that in our own ability. We don't do that in our own strength. We're not selling ourselves. We're not selling Christ. We go in boldness found in Christ and tell people about him, and we allow God to do the work in their lives. In verses 8 and 9, Paul reminds us that it's not about us, but it's about the greatness of God. Paul writes, to me, though I am the very least of all the saints, the grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to bring to light for everyone what is the plan of the mystery of God for ages, what is the plan of the mystery hidden for ages in God who created all things. Several times throughout Paul's writings, he'll say something along the lines that he does here, where he calls himself here he says that he is the least of all saints. In 1 Timothy 1:15, he calls himself the chief of sinners. I think there's two reasons Paul does this. One, he's Paul. I mean, let's be honest. He's, probably one of the greatest human Christians when it comes to following God. God used him immensely to plant churches, to see lives change. Part of this is Paul reminding himself that this isn't about him, that this is not his strength, this is not his power, that this is God. And it's a humility. An act of humility for him. So there might be some of us that need the same kind of humility, that to remind ourselves that we're not God's gift to the church or God's gift to the world. But I think on the flip side, I think it's a reminder or a declaration of God's greatness. That Paul is saying, hey, I'm the least. I'm the lowest. I'm well aware of my flaws. I'm well aware of my faults. I understand that anything that good that happens through me or in me, it comes from Christ. And Paul is making this declaration that even though his past is filled with attacking the church, seeing Christians arrested, seeing Christians murdered, Paul can say, regardless of who I was, regardless of my current struggles, it is not me who does this work, but it is God. I am the least of all believers. I am the worst of sinners, yet God still uses me. And it's a reminder for us that we don't have to have our life all together. We don't have to be perfect. We don't have to saying that even when your life doesn't do everything the way it's supposed to, you don't do everything perfectly, you don't have it all together, God can and will still use you. Your marriage is not perfect, God can still use you. Your kids aren't perfect, God can still use you. You're not perfect, you still struggle, God can still use you. That is not to excuse sin, but it's to say that God uses imperfect people to bring about His perfect plan every single day. And we don't need to allow just the lies of the enemy to say, well, you've done this and you failed here and you messed up here, to keep us from doing what God has called us to do. But we need to move forward with God and say, God, even though I'm not perfect, you are. So let me proclaim the perfection of God. That very quickly, this calls, Paul mentions it here, so I want us to say it, and I want us to understand that there is a kind of a bigger stage that we are playing on here. Paul says in verse 10, he says, so that through the church, we are the church, the manifold wisdom of God might now be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly places. So in 1 Peter 1:12, he says this. He says, in the things that you have now, that have now been announced to you through those who preach the good news to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven, things into which angels long to look. So when Paul talks about authorities in heavenly places, he's talking about, he's used this before, we saw this in Ephesians 1, he's talking about angels. And I think he's talking here about fallen angels and non-fallen angels, regular angels, angels and demons. So if you remember Isaiah and Revelation give us the snapshots of Satan's story, that he was an angel in heaven. He said, I want to be God. He fought against God. He got a third of the angels to go along with him. They failed miserably, got kicked out of heaven. So there's this kind of cosmic stage at play, that as the church does what the church is supposed to do, as we strive to proclaim the gospel, he says that it declares God's, it makes known God's manifold wisdom to the rulers and authorities in heavenly places. Understand that the angels that fell, they were never offered grace. Satan was never offered forgiveness. They were not made in the image of God. We are made in the image of God. So God loves us enough that he sent Jesus to die for us. And as we proclaim the gospel, there is this cosmic stage set up where they are watching us and looking at us and seeing this grace that God bestows upon us. Some cheering on and some hating and despising. But it tells us in the midst of all of this that God has loved humanity even more than the angels. And if God loves humanity enough to send his son, we should love people as well. And then we'll close with this in verses 12 and 13, or really 11 and 12. Paul closes by reminding them what God has done for them, hoping for them to realize the greatness of what God has done, and this will spur them on to telling others. So verses 11 and 12 say this. This was according to the eternal purpose that he has realized in Christ Jesus our Lord. So God's plans, purposes, they all center on Jesus. In whom we have boldness and access with confidence through faith in him. So what does he mean, boldness and access with confidence? Let's go back to that illustration Paul gave last week, where he talked about those barriers and those walls, where he's talking about that temple mount and how you had the Holy of Holies, then you had the holy place or the temple, you had all these courts, then you had the Gentiles over here separated. They couldn't go any farther. In Christ, there is access. In Christ, these barriers don't exist. And in Christ, we can walk right into the holy place, right into the most holy place, the Holy of Holies, where God's throne is, and we can praise him, and we can worship him, and we enter in as children, we enter in as sons and daughters through the sacrifice of Christ and our faith and our trust in him. We have access and confidence that God wants us to talk to him, that he wants us to pray, that he wants us to worship him, that he wants us to follow him. We have confidence that when we go to God, he has promised promised to hear us and to love us and not to reject us and not throw us to the side, but to say, I am yours and you are mine. We enter into his presence as a good, good father, and he loves us more than anyone else ever could. So Paul closes by reminding them, look, you used to be way over here. You were separated from God. But now, through Jesus Christ, you have the confidence and the boldness to enter into him. You have access to God, that when we pray, we are entering into the throne room of God to bring God himself, our request, our burdens, our needs, our praises. And this is the change that Christ brings to us. And this is the change that Christ offers to anyone who will place their faith and trust in him and repent of their sin. And Paul is encouraging these people. Prison might come, suffering might come, rejection might come. But if people trust in Christ, their eternity is changed. Their life is changed. Their relationship with God is changed. Where once there was separation, now there is confident access through Jesus Christ. I told you that I would close this up by tying this into Father's Day, and here's how I'll do that. For the church, if this is who we're going to be, for families, if this is who we're going to be, guess where it starts, men? It starts with you and it starts with me. The way God has ordered society, the way God has ordered the church, the way God has ordered the family. See, it said, men, you're the stewards. Here's your responsibility. Raise, lead, be the example. We cannot expect our spouses, we cannot expect our children to love God and follow him and tell other people about him if we're not doing it. And as a church, we cannot expect the lost to be saved. We cannot expect our church to grow if men, we are not leading the charge to be who God has called us to be and do what God has called us to do. If we're going to be fathers, if we're going to be men who love God and follow God, then we have to set the example. We have to lead the charge. We have to pray with our families and not just pray, God, let us have a good night's sleep and let us have a great day tomorrow, but God, burden our hearts for the lost. Pray for family members. Pray for neighbors specifically, knowing that they don't know Christ. And let your children, let your family members, let your Sunday school class, let your brothers and sisters in Christ see that, that we might lead, that we might lead the charge of being the people who proclaim the goodness of God, not just because we have a call. And yes, we have a call, and that is important. But without the gospel, lives are not changed. Eternity is not changed. And people go to hell. Men, let us lead the way. Women, if we're not leading, then you call us out on the carpet about it. You challenge us. I'm blessed with a wife that if I start to slip in ways of being the father that I need to be, she'll say, you've quit praying with the kids at night. You've quit reading the Bible with them in the morning. And that's the Holy Spirit using her to convict me to be who I need to be. Men, we have to lead. And if we will not, then God's not going to do anything. God has called us. God has placed it on us, and that is not a heavy burden. That is a gracious honor that God has given us. Let us be a church, men, women, youth, children, who proclaim the gospel and tell people about Christ, that their lives may be changed.